What's up, TJ? How's it going? Thank you for coming.
My pleasure.
You literally have no idea you saved my butt.
I'm glad I can help.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's just get straight into it. What are you doing? What's going on? Where are you going? I heard you're headed out soon to do a show.
Yeah, I'm getting ready to film my 20th season of The Challenge.
Sick.
Which is pretty sick. I'm very excited. I had no idea. Like when I first called Mira back in the day, he hosted it before me. He was like, yeah, you'll do one or two seasons and then you'll get over it. And all of a sudden, I'm 20 seasons later now. I'm like, oh my God, I still love this
job. And
you
still love it. That's awesome.
It's the best job in the world. I mean, what's not to love? Like we travel around and the whole crew is like a family. There's 60 people from 14 different countries all over the world. We like kind of plucked people out as we were going. If they were like really hard workers,
so it's
we would
most
use
of the
them.
Same people, like
yeah,
come back?
Most of the same people for the crew.
Yeah,
the cast is always changing up, but the crew is pretty solid, and we all like are pretty tight knit family.
That's so awesome. That's good because you want to have a good energy when you do things like that. You got to have people that are on the same page, that want what you want, that share your vision and share your passion. I think that's
no
the biggest
doubt about
thing, right?
It. And like you kind of meet this people, like-minded individuals kind of come together mm-hmm. at some point, you know, and like the first executive producer that I worked with, he was the guy that was in charge of the whole show, ran the whole thing, and it was one of his first seasons of being that guy, the main guy. It was like, I think it was his second season of being the main guy, and I was his second host, like Mira being the first.
Right.
But him and Mira didn't mesh that great. But they were cool. They just argued a little bit here and there. But he and I saw eye to eye right away, and we became like brothers. So
cool.
Yeah, it was awesome. And then he just moved on. He's doing bigger and better things.
So was this show? Well, first of all, explain what the show's about for anyone who hasn't seen it.
Okay, the show is not exactly my demographic. Okay, first of all,
fair
let's
enough.
Just get that straight. Okay, it's MTV, and it's kids that were on The Real World. Or Are You the One or The Road Rules.
I used to watch those all the time.
Same. So, well, I'm not Are You the One. I never saw that when I was a kid.
Because I don't think so, I saw that one either.
It's before our time, but
yeah.
I don't know how old you are, but I'm 40, so what are you going to do? And I was like, okay, let's do this. So it's those are the kids, when I say kids, they're like 25-year-old kids that are out there and they do crazy challenges for money. And they have a series of different challenges for a whole show, a whole season.
Like how much money? Because like people are like, would you jump into that freezing cold lake for like $100? I'm like, no, like no, like maybe not even for $1 million. Like no, I will not do that. I'm like, I know.
Dude,
I hate
that's
cold
not,
water.
That is not.
I would not be made for this, would
that's
I?
That's because you made way too much money. All right, I'd do it for $200,000, no problem.
Okay, but real talk, you know, yeah, nah, there's a point where I jump in cold water. But cold water is just a thing that I really, really hate. I'm like, I'm a weenie when it comes to cold water. People think I'm so tough. I'm like, yeah, watch me try to get into a really cold pool.
Yeah, cold
like,
pool
like, it's got to be warm. Like, ice baths, when I used to have to ice bath, oh, my gosh, I was so miserable. I hated life. I hated everyone around me.
It hurts.
For that. It's painful.
Yeah.
Until you get numb for that, like, first 2 minutes is pretty excruciating.
Exactly 2 minutes, too.
Yeah, it is. It's literally
exactly
almost that exactly 2 minute mark.
It's like, ow, okay.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. I'm numb now. Now I just can't feel anything.
I use my jacuzzi in the winter for that.
Oh, so you just turn the heat off to it and you just turn it like into
a and just go in there and I'm like, oh my God.
I have a pool out there and it's cold. Yeah. I haven't been in it yet because when I got this place, it was like end of July and it didn't move until September. So it was already kind of like really cooling down by the time I got in here. And I don't think I'll be getting in that. It's not heated. So I won't be getting in it until it's like 115 outside and the water's, you know.
85.
Yeah. Tempered for my taste. I like warm water. But okay, so what kind of challenges do the people do on this show and for what kind of money are we talking?
Well, we're talking for if you win the whole season, then it could be as much as $250,000.
Ooh.
So it's pretty good.
Yeah.
Then like certain challenges are worth like $10,000 or maybe they're worth nothing. They're just worth points to get to the end.
Oh, okay.
So they have to avoid getting sent into an elimination round as best they can. And then if they get into an elimination round, which is they go head to head to see who gets sent home. And so they had not to get sent home.
Are they usually like physical challenges?
Yeah.
Okay, so
mostly physical. Mostly. Yeah.
Not like eating nasty stuff, not like some mostly. Fear factor stuff. Mostly. But then there's a couple. But there's always that like, let's see how strong you really are mentally.
Yeah.
I like, always wanted to do a show like that, like Fear Factor.
Yeah.
Even Joe Rogan was doing that.
Yeah, it's almost the same as that.
Okay.
There's a lot of...
Pardon me, because I haven't had cable in like 10 years, so...
There's a lot of Fear Factor-ous things in it. Like last season, or two seasons ago, we had them put their heads in a glass bowl and then had it filled with snakes.
Oh!
Or had it filled with...
like poisonous
bugs,
ones? Not poisonous. Then, you can't do poisonous
No,
ones,
no
right?
poisonous, no.
Okay.
But then there was...
But they could technically bite you.
They could bite you, and it was
Like a little. I got bit by a gardener snake once. I grew up in Washington State, so it's not really like a lot of poisonous snakes. But I had no fear of snakes, like from like 2 years old, like no fear. I don't know if I'd want my head surrounded by a bowl of them, but I'll pick them up and like, and it bit my finger, and I just remember it was like felt like two little paper cuts. It was so weird. Yeah. So I mean, they can bite you even if though they're not poisonous.
And if they bite you in the face, it sucks.
Right. Keep your eyes closed.
No, I don't want that.
Okay, so yeah. Oh, that's... How many snakes did you put in there?
I think they loaded it up pretty good, but there was also...
Who thinks of this stuff? Who has the twisted mind to
There are some pretty amazing... Absolutely not.
No.
I'm not that creative. These guys come up with some cool things. Like,
yeah,
there's this
cool.
kid, Ryan Smith.
Cool, it's really cool to have your head...
This kid, Ryan, works on the show. He's... Badass dude. Another guy named Freddie. Like, those guys think up the craziest, most wild challenges you could think of. And they just search the internet, scour the internet, looking for different ideas and different inspirations. And they're like, that could be a challenge. Or that could be a challenge. And then, like, they think about it and then they put their own little twist on it. And it's just sick.
Crazy. What's the grossest one you've seen? Like, is there like a nasty
eating challenges? Eating challenges are disgusting.
What are they? Like, what are they?
I don't know. Like, it's usually a delicacy of whatever country we're in.
Oh, like...
And we've gone to some pretty crazy places.
Like, what's the one where they eat the... What is that called? Where they eat the half-grown chicken in the egg?
That is so gross.
Yes. What is that called? Do you remember?
No, but I hate it.
Oh, it's so gross.
Yeah. So gross.
So nasty. And it's like there's like little tiny furry feathers and the bones
and
are all
eyes
soft and stuff.
Everything.
And the beak.
You're just like, dude...
I can't remember what that's called. So I think it starts with a P. People are going to be watching this and be like, it's whatever,
yeah,
but
yeah,
I can't
know.
Think. Anyways,
but
you know what I'm talking about, though.
Disgusting. And I couldn't do it. Right. I'm like, dude, I'll do whatever. Like, I've done a lot of the challenges,
there.
Like a lot of the physical or the scary or whatever, like I would do. Like,
you
I
just
would,
did it too, just because?
Just for fun, yeah. Sometimes.
For fun.
Sometimes. But this.
Did you do the snake?
No.
Thing? No.
No, I had no interest in that. Like, that doesn't do it for me. Like, they had to use their mouths and bite cockroaches and spit them into a container as well. So they had to, like, use their mouths to get cockroaches in their mouth, come back out, spit it into a container, and whoever had more cockroaches in their container wins.
What were they picking the cockroaches
with their
up
mouths.
From? So they're just, like, in this tray or
yeah,
something?
Yeah, running around. Like, a lot of them. It was gross.
So you just like get a mouthful if you can of cockroach.
Yeah.
And spit it into a bowl.
Yeah.
And then they measure it.
It's interesting.
Wow. You have a lot of people will be like, I can't do that.
There's a lot of people that say that, but then I'm like, dude, have you ever seen the challenge?
Like, are you joking?
What are you
right
doing
now?
Here? Like, why are you here, bro?
Yeah. Because
you're taking up some room from somebody that would do this and that would die to do this.
What's the male to female ratio?
They're even, pretty much, yeah.
Very cool. That's crazy. I can't imagine doing that kind of stuff. But then I used to tell myself, like, if I was going to do a show like that, like, oh, I'd just not think about it and I would just do it and compartmentalize.
Yeah.
I guess that's what you have to do. You have to compartmentalize.
That's right. That's what I do for some of the disgusting things that I have to do in my work. My line of work. My new job.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Enlighten us.
Yeah. So... Like, I just got accepted into the Fire Academy for Henderson Fire here in Vegas, and I'm ecstatic. So I start that journey this summer, and right after we get done filming, I go right into the Academy and do that too. I'm not quitting the show, so take it easy. There's nobody. I'm not quitting.
He's not going anywhere. Don't worry.
I never quit. I'm just expanding. So, I'm going to the fire academy. I'm going to be a firefighter. I'm very excited. And compartmentalizing is a very big part of that.
Absolutely.
I had to do some 12-hour shifts at the emergency room for my EMT. And
oh, you see some crazy stuff.
Some of the stuff I had to do in there, I was like, nurses are the heroes of the hospital.
Right. They really are. That's all there is to it. They have to do all the grunge work. They have to do all the hard
stuff. So gnarly.
They're tough. I have a couple friends who are nurses, and I mean, one of my friends is like, always she'll send me, you know, Snapchats of herself, and she's explaining, you know, oh, that this patient just, you know, overdosed, you know, or I had a patient that this, and it's just like, it's so sad. I'm like, how do you deal with, like, how are you a normal person when you have to deal with, like, you know, or babies being born addicted, or, you know, just all this crazy stuff that happens in hospitals that they have to deal with on an everyday basis. It's like, how do you go back to a normal life after
the key word that you just said, compartmentalized. That's it.
I think a lot of athletes
very good at it.
Are really good at compartmentalizing too.
I really believe that. Yeah. I really believe it because we go through everyday life like just like every other person. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
And then we have to like put it out of our minds sometimes, and then just go do whatever we got to do.
Yeah, especially
and there's been a lot of gnarly things that happened to me personally while I've been on location. So it's crazy. Like a massive tragedy happens in my life when I'm on location.
Right.
You know, like one of my friends, Stephen Murray, got paralyzed from the neck down in a competition, and I got the text on set in Mexico. They were like, Stephen's in bad shape, you might not make it. I'm like, what? And then I had to go on screen, you know, and you're like you could just have to compartmentalize everything, you know, you just have to be like, okay, cool.
So yeah, about compartmentalizing, I know for me, like when I'm was in my training camps or getting ready for a fight, and you have just some shit go down in your life, and you're like, you still have to drag yourself to the gym, you still have to make yourself focus on the task at hand, and that's hard. People don't realize that, you know. It's like, so you when you're a professional athlete, you don't have time to shut down. Mm-mm. You don't have time to slow down because your competition's not.
Nope.
You know, it doesn't matter what's going on in their life. They're in their training too. So it's this like really high standard of like mental strength, I feel like, to be able to. And you know all about that too. You know,
mental toughness.
Being a professional BMX rider and everything. I wanted to talk to you about that as your career also. Through that transition, like, how do you even get started in something like that? What inspired
BMX?
You? Yeah.
Oh, like when I was a little kid, I grew up in this neighborhood. I used to ride my bike, and we had dirt jumps exactly where your house is. We had dirt jumps. Yeah. So I did one of my first backflips on dirt right up your street.
No way.
Yeah. So it's crazy because I grew up in this.
Wait, you did your first backflip? Aren't you supposed to do it with like a foam pit
first time? No, back then I didn't. There was no such thing as foam pits my whole life. I won the X Games twice before I ever touched a foam pit.
Damn.
So, like, everything I learned, was, like, crash, 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 stupid, idiot, crash, crash. Because I didn't know, like, foam pits even existed. And then I kind of knew they existed, and I was like, oh, that's whatever. I'm a dirt guy. And I'll just be a dirt jumper and just an idiot. And then when I found foam pits, my game elevated 50 million notches because I could do tricks over and over and over again in the foam pit and learn them solid and really get them down. And I'm so not against people doing that at all, because the way I did it and the way most people did it before me is too dangerous, and really it's not very smart.
I guess you gotta commit though, like when you go.
Yeah, you do. And it's just, I mean, we would ride with no helmets back then, and just, you know, it was
crazy,
no big deal.
Kids. How old were you when you did your first flip?
I think I was 16 years old.
Oh, wow.
Something like that. Like 16 on a bicycle. 15 or 16. And like on the dirt jumps. So
fun. And yeah, did you always aspire to be, you know, a high level BMX?
No, there was no such thing.
Really?
No. When I was growing up, there were no dirt jumpers. There was no such thing as a dirt jumper, which is what I became. And like X Games wasn't even invented yet until 1995.
Wow.
And so in 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, I was just racing.
Right.
And just doing tricks in the races and stuff. I was like going pretty good, but I wasn't lighting the world on fire or nothing. I was just having fun. And if they had if they had a contest at the races, it would be on a racetrack dirt jump, which is not a dirt jump. There's no lip to it. There's no, it's very rounded, very easy to jump and whatever. Right. And you could just do whatever tricks you could on that. And I won a couple of those. And then I slowly just started developing like the dirt jumps to be better, bigger and better. And like all the guys were building out the East Coast and stuff like that. And we would see each other's videos and we would all make lips and crazy jumps bigger and better and doubles bigger and better.
How do you make your jumps? Do you have like a little machine or something?
No, we use flathead shovels. Those are the, yeah, flathead shovels. That's what we do. I mean, we just use flathead shovels. Those are the best.
I mean, were you guys out there like shoveling dirt to make your?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. So we shovel dirt.
From what I understand, Vegas is not very easy to shovel dirt around.
No, it's not. Caliche is just the worst stuff in the world.
I was gonna say it's like rock bed, like rock underneath.
Yeah, some of it's rock, some of it's caliche, some of it's just sand.
I don't even know what caliche is.
Caliche is like an Indian, super hard mud. That they would build huts out of and stuff like that. Like, so it's like crazy because we have a whole city of it underneath Vegas, and that's just insane. And so when you dig up dirt and the key is water. So
yeah.
Every day it would rain. We would go build dirt jumps in the rain. So we would pack it all down.
And then pack it.
Yep. So you'd pack it, shape it, and then it would harden. Then you have a hard jump, so you could just do whatever you wanted to.
So crazy.
It was sick. And I mean, we made something out of nothing. It was pretty cool.
You're a badass, by the way.
No, for what? No.
Just all the stuff, like, all I've seen your videos of, like, crazy stuff you used to do. And, wow, I don't know. I was just showing you my dirt bikes, and you said you have a BMX track at your house,
yeah.
Which I know is like two totally different things. And I'm still a novice. I'm still like learning on my dirt bike. But when I first started riding, I was like, I don't even want to leave the ground. People are crazy that do that. And then you're like freaking trying to be Superman out there with the bike, like flying through the air, just doing flips and tricks and crazy stuff. But yeah, but I finally did get the bug, though. I finally like did a couple jumps. You know, I do tabletops and fun things like that, but I'm not trying to, like, I haven't done a double yet.
Have you like jumped up a lip, cleared it a section, and then landed into a landing, and it felt like nothing?
I haven't yet. I've only been doing tabletop, so
dude,
it's, you know, always that same.
So you go up and then land on top, and then So when you jump that jump and then you land into a landing,
where it's just like perfect,
your life is gonna change. It sucks. It's like, damn it.
Heed the warning.
Yes, because the feeling that feeling is, you can just do it over and over and over again, right? So
yeah.
The feeling of knocking somebody out,
right?
That rush,
yeah,
of knocking somebody out or winning a fight or
it's
tapping
like the
somebody out.
Perfect timing.
Like,
the
okay,
perfect.
You're just going as hard as you can, and all of a sudden you feel that. You're like, I just want everything. Like, that feeling is what you get every time that you jump a jump and land into a landing.
So awesome.
It's so addicting. It's insane.
I remember the first time that I rode on a track with my dirt bike, and I was like, well, how fun could this be? Like, you know, there's only so much to it. But I was so surprised how challenging and different challenges. Okay, but like, okay, this lap I'm gonna do this, or this lap, you know, because there's just so much more you can evolve to in that same track that I literally rode for like 5-6 hours and I had no problem at all. Like, I was just going. I loved it. I was,
and
like,
it's very, very cardio too.
Yeah,
like people don't realize how hard it is.
Oh yeah, no, they're like, oh, the bike does all the work.
Yeah,
I'm like,
the bike,
no, it
nothing.
Doesn't.
No, those are the most in shape athletes in the world.
Yeah, because
super,
they're actually moving the heavy hunk of metal around with their bodies
the whole time.
Like, you see the guys like that can like whip, you know, they just, I'm sure you're probably like, able to do all that stuff too. But like, I found it just, you know, it's humbling. It's amazing when you just watch it. You know, you can watch it on TV. You can go to an event and you're like, wow, it's cool. It's really amazing, impressive. But when you actually try a little bit yourself, you really start to understand how impressive it is.
And how good they really are.
Yeah. I'm like, damn, I would die. I'd be dead.
Yeah, you probably, if you sent it off of some of the jumps that they do,
oh,
it's like, dude,
I'd be sending myself to the grave as
come
well.
On, yeah, exactly.
But I don't get how when they're in the air and they like flip the bike sideways and they're like, they're like this, they go up and then they're like across the ground and then they flip the bike back up. I'm like, how
it's do momentum. You do that? It's all momentum, like, and it's all momentum, and it's all off
the
lip.
Well, you make it sound so easy, you know, but yeah.
It feels cool.
Yeah, I bet.
But
I don't know if I'll ever get there.
I'll tell you what, none of those guys could hold a candle to you in a ring, including myself. So there you go.
There we go.
Like,
we
just be like, uncle, everybody has their thing, you know?
Everyone so has their thing.
It's like, who's put 10,000 hours into this, that, and the other thing?
Yeah.
It's all it boils down to.
What about, I don't know, like, what about it, like, a really awesome memory for you? Like, what was your biggest, you know, your best accomplishment or the thing that you just feel the most proud about? It doesn't even have to be, you know, what everybody else thinks might be your best.
The thing that I'm most proud of is having my mom work for me. Swear to God.
Like, that's awesome. Because
she was, I was 22, and she was working at she's dealing cards at Bally's. And people in there, I mean, man, you guys are scumbags. Like, dude, this dude's in there?
Oh, yeah. Some people
are unbelievable. Like, how could you say that stuff to a person? Uh-huh. You know, in some cases, and like, just no humility at all. Just couldn't care less. Like, if these cards, I mean, when she was dealing, like when she first started dealing, somebody, and she was pregnant with me, and they were smoking cigarettes at the table, and they're like blowing it in her face, and like nothing, and she didn't even know. You know, nobody knew that would kill somebody when they were a kid. You know, but she was just like always mindful of it. And then, like, if you don't deal me, if I don't win this hand, your kid's gonna die.
What?
People saying things like that to her. And like, she dealt with the craziest things. And
it was like she hasn't any.
I know, exactly. Look at this place and then look at your house. Like, what's better?
Yeah, right.
What's bigger? What's better? Are you supposed to win? So that's what it all gambling boils down to. So like,
what are the odds? Like, let's just factor, let's put everything on the weigh scale, you know?
Just getting her out of the casino and to work for me, and just, and what she does is just takes care of my money. Like, so I have a barrier to go buy, you know, so if I wanted to have Motley Crue play my birthday or something, that was not going to happen when I was a kid, you know?
Right.
Like, I was like, hey, Mom, I need 50 grand. I need Tupac to play my birthday. Like, no, it's not going to happen. No, thanks, honey, but you're not going to do that, you know? So she helped me keep control of a 22, 23, 25-year-old kid that doesn't know what he's going to do.
That's so awesome. So your mom and you are very close.
Yeah, she's awesome.
That's the best. You know, like, people say, don't mix family and business, but when you can and it works, it's the best.
Yeah, well, she knows her role too. She's let me spend on stupid things or invest in stupid things too, because I called it and I was like, look, Mom, I need to do this. She's like, all right, I just so you know, I'm against this, but go ahead, do what you do.
Yeah.
And turns out 9 times out of 10, she was right. so
Mom knows best. Yeah,
you know, like, well, she's been on the planet longer than me, so you have to kind of like look at those things too. Like, I love sitting next to old people during flights. I always look for the old guy, and I'm like, I'm sitting next to that guy.
Wisdom, right?
Yep, wisdom.
They always say, what is it that the youth is wasted on the young?
Yeah, exactly. 100%.
When you're young and capable to do everything, you're too stupid to know, you know, how to use that time.
That's right.
It's funny.
That's 100% right. And like, I'm thinking all the stuff and all the contests and BMX things and stuff that I've been involved with, and I wouldn't even eat during the contest, like during the day before the contest. Like, I wouldn't even eat.
Why?
I was too nervous. So I was
nervous. Yeah.
Forget it. Don't even eat anything. So I'd go there just empty, full empty gas tank, and compete.
Full empty gas tank. Like, that's a little bit of oxymoron.
You think? So I'm like sitting there. I'm like, dude, that's the stupidest thing I've ever seen in my life. And I mean, sometimes I did good and sometimes I did bad. I'm like, man, I wonder how it'd be if I took up yoga back then, you know? Like,
some Zen in your life.
Yeah. Like, how good would I have been if I would have started doing yoga? And then I look at my friend Jamie Bestwick, who's, I don't know, he's got to be pushing 43, 44 maybe, and still the number one rider in the world on a vert ramp.
Damn.
Like, that's unbelievable. I mean, his skills and style are just far superior to anything I've ever seen. And the guy, it's because of yoga.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Because of yoga.
I really believe that. I don't know if he would say that, but I really believe that.
He has to have like some really stubborn nature to keep him mentally in the game for that long. Because I think when a lot of athletes retire, and I can speak as myself, it's not that I'm physically not capable. I'm really probably in my prime. Like, I still go to the gym, and like, I trash on boys. trash on men, you know, a lot of times. Not always, but, you know. Yeah, I mean, I do. I'm, like, very, very competitive, and I still enjoy that. But just you get to a point where you're just kind of checked out. Like, your mind, you're kind of just like, I'm just kind of done. Like, I've been doing this so long. I'm just... Mm-hmm. And especially, I feel like, if you're a passion-driven person, it's like... You get passionate about something, you're on it, you want to make the most of it, and then once you feel like you've kind of capitalized, you're kind of like, well, what else? You know, it's always something like, what's next? What more can I do? What else is out there? And that's kind of where I'm at, you know. I'm 30 years old.
So smart.
I've reached a pivot point, and, you know, that's why I'm doing the podcast too, because I'm like, hey, I want to find out what else is about me. Who else am I other than Misha Tate the Fighter?
Right.
You know, so just sitting down and talking to cool people is just something I enjoy.
Same.
It's passionate. It's awesome. Passion. Absolutely. Hell yeah. So it's always that transition. But to be back to that 43 or 44 years old and still be in that game and still be, I mean, there has to be like something, a mental fortitude that he has that's like next level. Like, I haven't even reached it. Like,
I haven't either. I don't know what that, I don't know what time that is, but all I know is that he is very, very good at what he does, and he lives in the middle of nowhere, Woodward, Pennsylvania, and like, I think that might have something to do with it. You know, State College and Woodward back there, back east, and you really, the only real fun that you can have, or the that, you know, people are coming to visit you all want to do is ride. So it's weird, like, his location and his mental, like, decision to move into a place that he was almost isolated where he lived. He was in Woodward, and he was just almost isolated and forced to become an amazing, the best rider of all time, in my opinion.
Damn.
Yeah.
Crazy. For
BMX Vert, I don't think there's anybody that can hold a candle to that guy. Like, his style and skill, and you know, I don't know. It's just nobody can touch him.
Did he start training really young too? Like, has he been doing it, or did he?
Yeah, he has. He's been doing it forever, and he was actually on the map, like, when I was like doing really well and winning big events. He was in there, but he wasn't quite what he is now. Dave Mira was still whooping his ass, and they were like going head to head, you know, and Matt Hoffman was still there too. Matt Hoffman, Jamie Bestwick, Dave Mira, Jay Miron, Dave Asato. These are some of the guys that were the top of the game. And Dennis McCoy. And I saw these guys on the vert ramp, and I saw them from the dirt course, because I'd be on the dirt course and whatever, but I would always watch them, and I just was so enamored with it. And I couldn't believe that they were doing the stuff that they were doing on the vert ramp.
Right.
Sorry, Simon Tebron too. Simon Tebron is sick, but these dudes, I just couldn't believe things they were doing on the vert ramp. And all of a sudden, Jamie, just 1 year, he took off his chest protector, and he just completely smashed everyone. And it was because he moved to Woodward. And then I really believe that him making that move from the UK, he's from England. And from the UK to Woodward, and really focusing everything 100%. And his wife, Carrie, they just put a whole thing down and just made it.
Wow. That's some commitment right there. And that's, I think, what it really takes to be the best.
That's same with fighting. Yeah. What are you going to do? I mean, you're going to move to the fight capital of the world.
Yeah, exactly.
And you're going to live right up the street from the fight gym.
Exactly.
And you're going to just go there and train every day. Like, and that's what you do.
That's life,
mm-hmm.
Right? It's crazy.
You could actually run to the gym from here, easy.
Uh-huh.
Just go down the train tracks.
So easy.
Train tracks is like the easiest way.
Right. Yeah. No, it's nice. I like living close to where I train and where I work out and stuff. It's just more convenient, you know. It's where even though I don't, you know, I don't fight anymore, I still like to do grappling competitions. I still like to train.
Yeah.
You know, I still like to do it. I'm always gonna be passionate about it. I'm always gonna wanna be involved in it in some way. But
yeah.
So what about injuries. You told me you just broke your leg, what, like a year ago?
I mean, like, let's just, I mean, it was just a little crack.
No big deal.
Yeah, that was whatever.
I love how athletes, like, always downplay. It was just, you know.
Yeah, it's just a hairline. Just a little, like. It was just a hairline. That was no big deal.
Like, what part of
but
your
But I've heard, it was my tib, but it was just, like, a little crack, and it was fine.
Yeah.
But what were you now. Doing? Riding motocross like an idiot.
That's what I thought. Because when I told you my bikes, you were like, yeah, well, I broke my leg, so
I don't do that anymore. I don't do that anymore because...
Like at all? You don't ride motocross anymore?
No, I don't do any kind of motocross, any kind of BMX.
You probably just get too tempted to get crazy, huh?
Yeah. And now I'm trying to go the firefighter route, so I can't get hurt.
That's so awesome.
I have to be healthy.
I think, like, when I think firefighter, I get nervous for people doing it, though, because I'm like, oh, just... I don't know that much about it, but I just picture, like, firefighters climbing into a burning house to, like, save a cat or save a, you know, person or whatever, which obviously it does. It does happen. That's a scary part to me, but I think at least in Vegas it's not quite so bad with that stuff, right? I mean, there's not as many,
yeah, I mean,
right? It's
there's
like
still
some
a lot
areas that's worse than others, or what do you think?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, the East Coast is definitely worse than the West Coast when it comes to fire. You know, things burning up and high rises and things like that burning up. And I mean, some of it's old construction too, you know what I mean? They're older out there, so their building classes are different and things like that. So in Las Vegas, for instance, we have an abundance of new construction. So those don't burn quite like the older construction, which are more on the east side or the north side of town. So those are the most, you know, burning areas of Las Vegas.
Why do you want to be a firefighter? Like, why?
I just love helping people. I've been like that my whole life, and I always wanted to be a firefighter. And I figure, you know what? Like, time is ticking, dude. You're 40. Like, it's time.
Do what you want to do.
Mm-hmm. Do what you want to do. Nothing for money, nothing for fame. Just something straight up.
That's awesome.
And so,
I love that.
Like, I was 36 when I decided, like, okay, I'm going to really give it a go.
Yeah.
And I'm 40 now, and I just finally got accepted to get into my first academy.
It's a process, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a very, very big process. You got to go through EMT school, become an EMT. You got to do some shifts. You got to really, like...
Volunteer shifts, basically?
Yeah, volunteer for the EMT stuff. You got to, like, figure it out and really have to decide if that's going to be your deal.
Calling, mm-hmm. Yeah. But you've liked everything so far?
So far, I'm like, this is it. This is it for me. Yeah, I love it. And it's badass. And I was inspired as well. Like, I saw a couple of firefighters that really inspired me to pursue it very, very hard. And one of them is Stipe Miocic.
Yeah.
I was like, man, I love that. I was already pursuing it when I found out that he was in the fire department. And I was like, see, I knew it.
Yeah.
I knew you could do something
you
else
could
too.
Do it.
Like, I knew it because he's doing something a little bit. You know, he's pretty good.
Yeah. Well, exactly. No, he's balancing two heavy careers. That's for sure. Then.
And that's exactly where I started, and I was doing BMX and TV, and then I would like fly from Trinidad to Louisville, compete, then go back to Trinidad and finish the show. So. It was a pretty crazy, hectic schedule, and balancing two careers was really hard. And so I figured I could do that again, easy, with firefighting.
How long did you compete for?
I competed for almost 20 years.
Wow.
Yeah.
Did you feel burnt out at all at the end, or were you still like...
I was a little bit spent. I was like, man, I don't need to do any more contests, really, and then... I crashed pretty good, so in 2010. So, like that, I didn't bow out gracefully. Let's just say that, like, what you did, way smarter. Like, go out on top. Go out doing you, and knowing that you could still go back if you wanted to.
Yeah.
Before you're forced out of the game, like being, I always looked up to Ricky Carmichael for that, because he bowed out. on the top.
I love Ricky.
Yeah, he's awesome.
So awesome.
And he just was
such
like
such a humble, nice guy.
Such too. A sweetheart, and I love him too. And he and I were Fox teammates, and he like we would talk about everything in the world, and he bowed out, and when he did, I was like, man, he's making a mistake. Why is he doing that? And I'd never got it until I didn't bow out at the right time. And it's because the passion wasn't there anymore. And like the drive to actually do something that gnarly. And motocross is gnarly, dude. Like if your head's not in it, you're done. Yeah. You're getting hurt bad. And right. He knows it.
Absolutely.
So he bowed out at the right time. And for him to have the balls to just be like, you know what? I'm out.
Right?
It was scary. Unbelievable.
It's scary. Cause
so scary.
Change is scary.
It's so scary.
For one. And, but being honest with yourself, I guess that's where it really is. You know, if you can really sit back and look objectively and not just say, you know, I'm going to do this because it's what I know, or it's all I know, or it's I have
right.
to, or,
right.
you know, I feel the pressure to.
The money,
but it's like,
this,
yeah, money. Yeah. You know, if you just sit back and you're like, you know, I'm going to be honest with myself. I'm not 100% in this
right.
anymore. And if you're not 100% in it, you know, they're both dangerous sports. Like,
yeah,
you know,
dude,
all
totally.
Dangerous sports.
Fighting
if you're
is gnarly. 100%
in it, you just, I don't, in my opinion, you shouldn't be in it then.
BMX, same thing. Fighting, same thing. Motocross, same thing. Anything that you're not in it besides golf, you're in trouble. Like, if you're not really feeling it in golf, stay in it for the money. But if you're in a dangerous sport,
right.
you know, I mean, but
yeah.
if you're riding the pine in baseball, just ride it out.
Just, yeah,
just ride it out. You'll be
collecting.
All right.
Keep rolling.
Yeah,
the
dude. But if you're in football, on the other hand,
football, man,
I'd bow out of football if I wasn't feeling it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, if you're not feeling it, you should probably get out.
I personally think football is more dangerous than MMA, depending on the position you play, obviously.
I think so too. I mean, you're coming across the middle at a wide receiver, and you got a linebacker take your head off. That's done.
Oh, especially
done.
When you don't see it coming.
Yeah, dude.
I mean, you see some of those guys get clipped, and they just had no, and they're
no.
they're down for the count.
Oh my
it's
God.
Like they got hit by a truck. You know,
so gnarly, and the top of the head thing. I really believe that it's a very dangerous
sport. Or
the sport.
Knees, man. You've seen those. Have you ever seen like the nasty football highlights where it's like this guy's foot just like spins around, like, and his knees just like it's just gone. I was like, I don't know if there's
yeah.
even any fixing that. So
that happens a lot in BMX too. Like BMX
oh, I bet.
Is pretty.
'Cause you're, oh yeah.
Yeah.
So did you say your worst injury was that big crash?
I mean, that was the most. I mean, it took 5 years to get 100%. But yeah,
it's no joke.
Yeah, 5 years to be like, all right, cool, I'm good, I'm better. so like, at 6 months, I was back on TV.
Wow.
Which was really really hard, but like that guy Justin Booth, he's my boy. He was just like, I'll feed him line by line. I don't care. That's my guy. So he like. Held my hand in Costa Rica pretty much and just got me to do it and I did it. It was cool.
Damn. So what was the most difficult process of that? I mean, the you have a big wreck like that, obviously it changes things, you know? I mean, I suppose not only like the fear that you probably envelop too, like when you have that bad of a wreck, it's a realization, isn't it? I mean, that can even happen.
Well, first of all, when you wake up, you're scared because it was 2 weeks later. So you're like, I remember waking up and I was like, man, I really did it this time. That's what I was thinking. I was like, damn, how am I going to pay for this? That was my first thought. How am I going to pay for this?
Yeah.
And then I was thinking, like, what the hell happened like that? And that was a hard hit. And I was like, well, I'll be all right. This has been happening plenty of times. And then I tried to get out of bed, and I crashed right away. And I just started pissing all over the hallway. Like, I thought that was the bathroom, and it wasn't. And
oh
it was
my
just
gosh.
Like...
so disoriented.
Yeah. Like, and, like, everybody was blurry because I had double vision for a minute. And then my buddy Reed Johnson, he's a baseball player, he was like, helping me go to the bathroom, and he's like, dude, just tell your buddies to wear full face helmets because it's way cooler to wear a full face than have your buddy hold your piece while you're trying to take a piss. And I was like, dude, you're right. Okay, I'll do that. So I'm sitting there, I can't even barely walk, and I get back to the bed, and I'm just like, man, here we go. So that was the start of a pretty lengthy
recovery,
yeah, and like learning how to count money and all that stuff too. But like when I say learning, like you're just relearning the things. Like it's right. not you're not like relearning all of it from ground zero.
Right.
You kind of have an idea about stuff, and you're like, I don't really know how to add that up, but I know how to add that up.
Right. So it's like refresher.
It's just refresher, really. I mean, if somebody tells you once, so like a nurse taught me that it's like taking your file cabinets that are all in your brain and just throwing them in the air into a room. And so all the
stuff,
everything is just completely hammered. And all you have to do is just put everything in alphabetical order where it goes.
Yeah.
So that's basically like you have all the stuff. You just need to put it all back. And I was like, okay. Well, since that was a very good analogy for me. And I was like, okay, cool. And then so I took all that and I learned all that and I did everything I needed to learn and the walking and the talking. Like the talking was weird because my tongue wouldn't go in the right place. So I was like slurring my words and like you have to really sharpen your tongue.
Yeah.
So, you know what that means? Like that means like making every word pronunciation proper and everything else. And so it was really hard because I'd blur the words. Like almost my handwriting would just be like tailing off because I was in a rush trying to say things properly.
Right.
And then,
well, it's probably like that muscle memory, like where you know the speed and you're used to that, what you should be saying, but it's the things aren't like necessarily here I am.
Yeah.
They're not coming
what are you
out.
Doing, dude?
No. Yeah, right. They're not like necessarily coming out the way that you're thinking, thinking.
Yeah, exactly. So you're like, dude, I'm just gonna have to figure this out. So every single word would be like put your tongue on the teeth for this one and like yeah. in speech class every day.
Yeah.
So then it was just tongue sharpened, good go. Let's go.
I had a friend of mine who was in a logging accident, had a severe brain injury. Actually, part of his skull was crushed in from a log hitting him in the head, and it was a long, long process, and it was the same thing. You know, he was in a coma for a little while, and then, you know, when he would come out, it was dealing with him, it was like we were dealing with his brain swelling and all that, the pressure, and like just for the longest time, but he's having to relearn. He's talking now, he's walking, you know, but it's a slow process, but just the amount of improvement that he's had since that severe brain injury is just, it's amazing. It's like, yeah. He's my hero, you know? It's like,
yeah.
how do you do that? How do you get through something like that?
Well, you have to have a solid support system. That's number one, you know? My mom was sick and then she was awesome. So she helped me out a lot. And then, but my wife, Roxanne, she did everything. Like you name it, you know, she was there.
Yeah, that's my alarm.
She was there from the start. She was like, we're doing this. And you know, like, I remember, like, when I first got out of rehab, the first rehab, she was like, okay, you're home now. Now it's time to go to Tim Soder's, which is, like, a rehab facility here in Vegas.
Yeah.
Like, physical therapy. And I was like, can we just go, like in a couple months?
Right.
Yeah, because you're so unmotivated from therapy. You're like, dude, I don't even want to talk about therapy. She's like, nope, you have to go.
Now.
And she made the appointment, and we were there Monday. You know, so then it was like, you're going here now. So it was she was very, very hands-on and very helpful, you know. Like, and it's not easy to deal with somebody like that, like, because you're not you when you have a brain injury. You know,
right,
you're not,
right.
You don't know. She had no idea what I was going to come out. You know, as yeah. And she was right there, so it was pretty solid.
So when you were unconscious for 2 weeks, what is that what you said?
I think almost 2 weeks.
Almost
yeah.
2 weeks. Was it like was any of it medically induced or
yes,
were you just
yes.
Okay? It was.
It was because I don't know exactly what happened, but whatever happened, the brain was bleeding, and they were like, "Oh my God, we got to put him under," because I didn't wake up yet or nothing, but while I was sleeping, they just put me in a medically induced coma. I don't really know how that works. like how you go from coma to medically induced, and I really don't know how you wake up from any of that. But
right.
But
it, yeah, that stuff's beyond me.
Yeah, me too. It's way above my pay grade.
Well, you're getting there. You're going to be a firefighter. You're going to have to probably learn more about that stuff, right?
No.
Not at all?
No.
Well, no, when you were in the hospital, though, yeah, you said that you were...
I did learn a lot in the hospital, yes. I learned a lot. And I, you know, EMT school was amazing.
Yeah.
It was really cool. I think that everybody should take an EMT basic course, for sure. Like, especially people that are going to have kids.
Really?
Yes. If you're going to have kids, you should have an EMT course, because... you learn so much.
Really?
Yeah.
And well, what do you think is the best thing that you learned from it?
I mean, I've learned a lot, like, about the arteries and things like that. Like, arteries are away from the heart. Veins are going into the heart.
Yes.
I had no idea about that. Okay. Well, if you hit your main arteries, you could die and bleed out and pretty fast.
Yep.
So when you break a femur, for instance, like, I've had several people break femurs.
Femoral artery, is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So if you break a femur... the chances are really good that you sever that femoral artery. And if you do that, you're going to die.
Right.
So the key to fixing that is just putting a tourniquet right away, right in the groin, and just tie it up.
Tight.
And tight. And make sure that that doesn't happen. Now, you have a bunch of other things that you're going to have to maybe deal with if you leave it on there too long. Like if you're in a 2-hour... away from a hospital somewhere. No, not necessarily. Like that's a rumor that people think that.
Myth.
Yeah, that's a myth, an old school myth. And like if you develop some kind of a compartment syndrome or things like this, but those are far few between, and it's far better than the alternative.
Dying.
You know what I mean? So I'm like,
pick your poison.
I look at it, I'm like, man, I saw 5 broken femurs in my life, maybe 6.
Damn.
And I never put a tourniquet on somebody. I just would like take them to the hospital, drag them, firemen carry them to their car. Nobody cared about that stuff when I was growing up, you know? Like,
well, they didn't know.
No, we didn't know. So if we were forced to take EMT school, then we would all know that. You know what I mean? And it's like, that's why I tell all my friends, I'm like, dude, if one of us breaks our femur, hook them up with a tourniquet before you take them, just in case. Because I had a friend die just last year in motocross, broke his femur right out here, and nobody knew that you just tie it off and be good. And he died.
Wow.
And it's insane. And it's like, how did that happen? And that was, he just overshot a jump, you know, and blew up. And it's crazy, man. Like, that stuff is dangerous.
Yeah. So do you try to stay pretty, you know, pretty injury-free now, pretty low-key? Yes.
I'm very, very low-key, especially with the fire department.
Do you ride at all anymore?
Well, the other day I did a lap around the backyard for Dave Mira, like, because it was his birthday. So I was like, yeah, man, I'm going to go back there and bang it out.
Cool.
So I had to hook up a little table for Dave Mira. And but that's it. I don't really ride BMX too much. A little bit here and there, but I'm off the bike now 100% because I got accepted in the fire academy. So from here on out.
Congratulations, by the way.
It's fireman. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Yeah, it's something that I really, really want to do, and I'm honored that they actually are gonna give me a chance, you know.
Hell yeah.
So that's
cool. It's exciting.
Yeah.
It's really exciting.
It's awesome.
I know it's not an easy position to get into. So
no,
it's a lot of work and persistence. And
yeah, persistence is key. Like, well, if you guys don't take me now, I'm just going to be back next year. That's what it all boils down to.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, just keep on going.
Yeah. What does your wife think about it? Does she like you doing it?
Yeah, she's very, very excited for me. She's,
good.
You know, she knows how bad I want to do it. And
she sounds like a great woman.
Yeah, she's awesome. So, like, we have our gym at my house, and she runs that, and that's awesome, good times. And then she does Pilates instructing, too, at CORE.
Cool.
So she's doing her thing.
Oh, yeah. I know we were speaking about injuries a second ago, and I wanted to bring it up to you because I didn't know if you ever knew. And now you're pretty injury-free. You have kids, though?
Yeah.
You have kids?
Yeah, we have one.
One.
She's 18.
Oh, okay.
So if you want to call her, we have one adult.
One adult. True now, right?
Damn it.
That must mean we're all getting old. It's like, it's so weird when you watch, you meet kids that are like 5 years old, you know, and then like 6 years later, 10 years later, you see them and they're like, what happened? You know,
yeah.
Like, that's such a weird feeling. And you remember when you were that kid and then like you wouldn't see someone forever?
I've known you since you were,
yeah, this, yep. And now, yep. Yep. And I'm, yep. Like, now we're those people.
I know. So I know. And we're those ancient dinosaurs.
Oh,
I can't
no.
believe it. I don't feel like it, though.
Well, I'm not going to say I'm an ancient dinosaur yet. I got, 10 more years before.
I got something for you in my pocket. Oh, here it is. Yeah, these shoes are 30, so I think you're going to be fine.
Right. Oh, but I was going to tell you about injuries. Did you know that icing them is, the worst thing you can do?
No.
Yes. Is that weird?
Yeah.
It's a total.
Who told you that?
It's a total myth. I did a podcast with the anti-Iceman. His name is Gary Reinel. And I knew you would appreciate this because you've been an athlete your whole life. And I guarantee you've been told your whole life, ice it, right?
Reduce the swelling.
Reduce the swelling, right. So it's crazy because icing actually, so you're talking about arteries and veins and all that stuff, right? So you got to think that your veins and those things are your passageways to get inflammation out. Like, those are your highways, those are your roads.
Yes.
So everything goes in, everything goes out. That's the one way in, one way out, right?
Right.
So if you put ice on it, it's actually a vasoconstrictor.
Constrictor, right?
So everything just, but it doesn't, it hasn't get it out then. The inflammation can't go out. And it's your body's natural healing system anyway. So as soon as you take the ice off, what's it going to do? It's going to continue.
Expand and
its
blow
process
up.
Is not, never, it doesn't stop it. It just slows it down. So it actually sort of inhibits, but does it inhibits recovery? It's not like it's
feels good.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah,
it does feel good. It numbs crazy. It, but it's a total myth. There's actually been 4 studies done of peer reviews that say never has it been proven that icing has helped anything. There's never been a study ever done. Actually, there's a study that was done that was trying to prove how icing was helped, and it actually reversed the study into how it doesn't help. Because they
that
have
is
two
so
control
cool.
groups. Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
You have to listen
and
to that
it makes
one.
Perfect sense when you say it like
it does,
that.
It You're does.
Like,
it does.
Duh.
It's crazy.
That's the same with heat.
Yeah. It's crazy.
They said that they did the heat thing too.
Yeah.
It just feels
so
good.
Your lymphatic system is the only way that you can get it out, which is a passive system. So you got to just move your muscles, essentially. That's how you get swelling and recovery and how you get it going, not by icing.
Just
isn't
moving.
That weird? So it's just literally was a fad, like rice. Rice is nice, you know, rest, ice, compression, elevation. It just caught on. You know, fads just catch on, fad diets, fad things. It caught on because a kid lost his arm. I think it was back in the 60s, and they put that limb on ice, and they were able to reattach it, and that's how the whole thing just started, was because people were like, oh, ice must be amazing because this kid was able, you know, but that was a body part that was disconnected.
I think putting a limb on ice would be good because then it just keeps the...
Yes, because what does it do? It constricts everything. Nothing moves. Nothing is so you're keeping it preserved.
Right.
But if it's a healthy body part that's still attached, that's having your regular blood flow, let it do its thing.
Yeah.
Go for a walk, you know, if your ankle's swollen a little bit or you have a knee, if you can, obviously, go for a walk or roll your ankle. When you're on a flight next time,
do
that. That'll help instead of your ankles getting swollen. Or I go to the bathroom and I do squats. I go to the bathroom. You know, because if I just do 15 to 10, you know, squats or whatever, I feel really good. And blew my mind. So anyways, I had to pass it on.
That is crazy.
I know as an athlete, your whole, I know me too. You know, I did it my whole,
never
my
once
whole
did
life,
I ever
my
know
whole
that.
Career. Yeah.
I've sat in my jacuzzi a lot. Ice bath and not, you know, like
what? Yeah, I don't know for sure about the ice bath. There's some mixed reviews. Now Gary Reinel, the anti-Iceman, will say it doesn't help. My physical therapist at the gym says, well, there's different things that the ice bath helps with, like, you know, different stress factors on the body and different things like that. So he says it can. I'm not 100% sure, but I know that isolating a specific small piece of your body doesn't help. And a lot of times it could cause more damage, actually, because the tissue that, you know, you can damage tissue by icing it too long. So it's going to cause more inflammation.
Oh my God.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
Well, literally my mind was blown. But if you get a chance to listen to that one, it was a good one. I had to tell you that, but yeah.
Nice.
But anyways, well, thank you so much for coming on today. I think I've taken up enough of your day. So we're going to go record your podcast now.
Yeah, yeah. We're going to do Hanging with Labs right now.
All
right. That's my vlog I do just online. But me and Forrest Griffin, we have a podcast coming out called Anything Goes.
Hilarious.
I know. So he's...
Well, maybe I can come on there.
No, you are coming on. Oh, for sure.
I am. Okay.
Yes, 100%.
Perfect.
No,
when does that come out?
We are going to start in June. So all the free time that I have, you know, like from... So yeah, no, we're gonna start it in June or July. Yeah, so it's going to be pretty crazy because the Academy is going to be my first... and foremost thing and that I have to worry about and get that going. But I have a little bit of free time here and there and whatever free time I do have.
Podcast it up. It.
Yeah, man, we're going to podcast it up. So Roxanne and Vacations are on the back burner. She's on her own. She's doing everything with her gypsies right now, like she's in Costa Rica. So she's...
Are you?
I'm not allowed to be on vacation right now. I am very much... in work mode.
You're working.
Mm-hmm.
Working hard or hardly working?
I'm working hard at hardly working.
There you go. That's what I like. Awesome. Peace out, everybody.